Colette, moving on to myth number three, the group myth. It is better to be part of a group than to be an individual.
Yes. Now, there seems to be, if we look at biology or evolutionary theory or social theory in many ways, is our need to belong, I think, is very strong, and there could be all sorts of reasons for that. We want to be liked. We want to feel a sense of community and we-ness. And often for vegans, of course, is we find our family, our new tribe. We heave this sigh of relief. Oh, my gosh, at last people understand me. We become part of something. Oh, I'm an animal activist. Oh, I'm whatever. And that need would seem to be very powerful in human beings. But to belong to those groups, there, if people are not open-minded about how you can recreate and be authentic about how you want to behave together, you can slide into the group myth, which means in order to be part of that club, you have to conform and do certain things. Okay, now the first group, of course, is family. and I think I haven't got the book in front of me to quote it, but there's a lovely existential quote there that just talks about the huge power of the family. Families exert enormous pressure if their members don't conform to what is agreed within that family. So if someone really believes that everybody should go home for Christmas or Thanksgiving, if they don't, they may be emotionally or physically ejected from the family. They're given the cold shoulder. They are not talked to at forthcoming family events in an attempt to exclude them from the group, to by saying, if you moderate your behavior and play the game of what we have, because this is what we always do every time of year at Christmas. So the power to be in the group, if you want to be having certain of your needs to be part of community, you've got to conform and act a certain way, okay? And so the family is that, and career groups are that, professions are that, workplaces are that. You know, we're coming up to a time of the year when I really hope and have strong beliefs that this will be the last one. People abroad, we have something called the Melbourne Cup, which is the horse racing. Had the most extraordinary and heinous exposés over the last 8 years at least. But we've had a very big expose, which is really forcing Australians to really not be part of that very cruel situation. But in a workplace, people would have what's called a sweepstake, and people all put money on to say which horse is going to win. And you might know, if you can cast yourself back to corporate life, Natasha and Luca, is if you don't perform to that, it's, oh, come on, don't be unreasonable. This is really, you know, it's all only a little bit of fun.
Yeah.
And you're seen to be odd. And now for someone who's in their power says, thanks, but no thanks. Or certainly the activists would use that as an opportunity to outreach. But for a lot of people, they feel silly. I think the fear of feeling silly or feeling stupid or feeling less than is so great that they conform to the group myth, i.e. moderate their behavior. If I want to be in a club, that actually would have me as a member.
Yeah, I think this is probably the hardest one, where people may think, okay, I want to change something. And then the very first barrier, I think, is the group myth in terms of my family, my friends, my colleagues. What are they going to think? How am I going to continue these relationships if I change? And I think that's where most people just go, not too hard, backing away.
I think a tool, therefore, coming out of what you've been talking about for our listeners is learning to say no. That's the first one, is actually, so think about what is in your life that you don't want to do. Maybe you don't want to go and have a Sunday lunch with your family every weekend. So find a way to say no, because when you say no, you are, unless you really want to go there every weekend, but if you're going, oh God, I really want to keep doing this, or not every weekend, maybe once, is there is an opportunity there. You are, if you go along with it, you're choosing to that the discomfort of being there and foregoing what you want to do on a Sunday afternoon is more comfortable than actually saying no to them and having the potential kickback from that. Okay, so learning to say no, and if we just say, no, I'm not coming, people are going to ask you 50 questions to try and influence. If you show them that you've thought this out and say, hey, look, I know Sunday's really important to you and we get together and we do this or whatever tradition it might be, and I really appreciate that. However, I'm not able to come every weekend, but I'd love to come. And if we can find some other time in the rest of the month, whatever, that would be great. Then stop. Allow people their right to give you some kickback. I can't believe you're so selfish. We always do this. You know, I hardly ever see you. What sort of a daughter are you? Or whatever. Or the cold shoulder, you know, is we're not really afraid of other people's reactions. We're afraid of our feelings in relation to those reactions. When you can, we can live with the self-consciousness or any discomfort that actually comes from us saying no and the kickback, then we can learn to stay in our power and also be understanding that, you know, other people may be disappointed. Just because they're disappointed doesn't mean we've got to move ourselves into disappointment to actually, you know, get them out of it.
Oh, yeah, I mean, love that.
We said at the beginning that there were going to be some truth bombs, and they just keep you.
You
keep
just
dropping
dropped
them,
one, Claire.
Yeah, I really appreciate you empowering our listeners with such great tools. And I'm reminded actually of our recent tour where I was speaking with a young activist, a lovely guy.
I knew you were going to give this example. You? I was thinking of it too.
Yeah. And I remember I was speaking with this young activist after the workshop, and I was saying, oh, so we'll see you at the, I don't know whether it was the Dominion film screening or the vigil.
I think it was the vigil.
Right. Mm. And he said, oh, look, I'd really love to come. I have not bared witness at a vigil before, but I have a family commitment that day. So I'm pretty sure I won't be able to make it. And I said, oh, is it, you know, a flexible...